and we put them in a very, how do you put it, in a way that everybody is able to understand, right? And in a way that everybody is able to connect. So what we do is we have divided all of this into 7 stages, right? Would you, yeah, please come on in, guys. Would you like to know what those 7 stages are?
Yes.
So what is it that the first thing that you do when you talk to a person? Oh, by the way, I hope you're able to see the screen. So what is it that the first thing you do when you talk to a person or when you meet a person?
Greet,
yes.
Handshake.
Smile. Okay.
Eye contact.
I'm looking for one particular term.
Introduce.
Yes.
Connect.
Closer to that.
Greet.
It's called the icebreaker. Now just imagine. So I'll be using this example very often because it kind of connects to everyone, I hope so, please. So you are at a networking event, right? What is the technical fest that you guys have in here, in SAP?
Tech Ed.
All right, let's say you are at Tech Ed, right? So I'm assuming that there is a networking event after that, before that?
Yes.
Okay, so now you are at this event with your manager, with your teammates, and you meet your vice president or a president or I don't know, your CEO comes here and you happen to meet them. Your managers probably introduce you to them. What do you do?
Say hi.
Okay. You just say hi to
the like,
CEO of a $1 billion company. You introduce, yes. So now let's look at this. So what if your manager does this? So by the way, this is from a sitcom called How I Met Your Mother. And it's a game where Barney, Ted's wingman, tries to get him to introduce to women so that, you know, further things can happen. So now let's imagine that your manager does this. He just goes to, like, who's your CEO?
Bill.
He goes to Bill and he says, "Hi Bill, this is Maithili." What do you do?
It's a pleasure to meet you, Bill.
Yes, excellent. Good one. Now, will you do that? It says life without you would be like a broken pencil, pointless. It's a very good one-liner, like a what do you call those pickup lines. It's a very good pickup line. But does it work when you're meeting someone like Bill? You know, doesn't work. So you need to know what to speak in front of who, and you need to know context. Somebody said context, right? So you need to introduce yourself in a way that is contextual. You need to probably, let's say, Internet of Things, right? So you can just like go and ask Bill, like, "Hi Bill, I've been wondering about the Internet of Things strategy for SAP. What do you think?" Right? So you need to have context. Now that you've introduced yourself, okay, he knows you are Maithili, and you know that he's Bill. Now what next? Now you need to have a conversation with that person, right? And now I'm opening it up for not just your business communication, I'm opening it up for personal life, your relationships, your professional life, your day-to-day meetings, right? So now what do you do when you want to have a conversation further with someone?
I think that person like Bill, so, and like if like we are meeting, so we should learn from them. So this is an opportunity we can ask such good questions.
Correct.
Like how you read that position or some challenges you faced in your...
Correct. That is context. What I'm talking about is how do you do it, right? The how part of it.
We find something in common. Like if they are in ticket, I'm also in ticket. Some talk something is in ticket.
Okay. Yes.
Ask questions.
I'm looking for one question.
Talk with the vision,
yes.
Of vision with the SAP, like, because CEOs mostly talk with the vision. So we can start one of the point and
yes.
how and I and he think.
He's coming close. What I'm actually looking at is how do you structure your thoughts when you talk to someone? You have an opening. "Hi Bill, I'm Maithili." You opened it up. Now how do you take it forward? How is it that you can have an effective conversation with people? Right? You need to have a clear opening, clear body, clear conclusion. Right? In Toastmasters traditional platform, as far as I remember when I did it back in the day, this is called CC2. Yes? why don't we apply that in our meetings, let's say? How many times have we seen meetings getting extended? How many times have we seen an additional meeting being requested because the content of today's meeting was not able to be, you know, what was not completed, was not finished? How many times have we seen questions being asked that are longer than answers? How many times have we seen people getting into too much technical details in a way that you'll probably expect they'll start writing code there itself? You know, from a business level angle, they go to be so deep that it takes 20 minutes for them to expound on one particular topic. How many times have we seen that? And can we make sure that our presentations, our thoughts, our processes are so simple and so structured that we do not require a follow-up? That all our meetings end in time, including the time required for people to ask questions. Can we do that? This meeting is just an example. But a lot of times, we are not, I find this example very peculiar. You know, proposals. Most of the times when you propose to somebody, I'm talking about romantic proposals, when you propose to somebody, you get all flustered in there. And you're like, I like, love you, I don't, I, I'm, I, will you marry my mother? And I'm like, what? So what I wanted to convey was, I really love you. Will you marry me and be the mother of my children? Right? Or in the other case, the father. But that may happen anyway. So I got all flustered and the whole point was lost. Right? So can we have a structure to our thoughts? Now going ahead. Okay, now we have made an introduction and we have structured our thoughts. What next?
Presentation.
Yes. He conveyed it in a different manner, but what I'm actually looking at is, are you able to pinpoint your content, or are you beating around the bush? How many times have you seen that happening? Right? So do you have a point? If you have a point, trust me, you will never fail. I'm sorry, what was the time I told you?
15.
10 to 15 to 20. 15, 17. So how good am I?
10.
Alright. Awesome. So are you able to actually get to the point? Or are you just beating around the bush? Again, this goes back to the previous one. Where if you have to deliver a presentation, if you have to talk to somebody. Because see, trust me guys, Bill is the CEO, for example, of a multi-billion dollar company. He does not have the luxury of time. He probably has 30 seconds. How many of you have heard of this particular phenomenon, which is called an elevator pitch? Yes? What do we do in an elevator pitch?
In 90 seconds, you want to talk about all the best things that you want to say to the
others. Right. So, as the name would suggest, an elevator pitch is where you schedule a meeting with the CEO of your, or the MD of your company, and you convince him of an idea in 90 seconds. 90 seconds. I've spoken around 10 times more than that right now. Are you able to convey this idea, this groundbreaking idea, in 90 seconds? You need to be on point. You do not have the luxury of time of saying, hi, you know what, my name is this, I work for this team, and I earn that much, and you know, I live with my kids. No, you don't have the time. You just have to get to the point straight away. So are you able to do that? That's very essential, because a lot of times people, oh, okay, this very good example is, college. I hope everybody has been to college. So,
yes.
How many of you have hated the lectures because you just kind of stepped away? Yes. Why? Because our professors, no offense, if anybody is mom or dad is a professor here, our professors are incompetent when it comes to the art of delivery. Trust me, the best universities in the world, the Harvards, the Stanfords, the MITs, the Oxfords, they are not the best because they have a huge infrastructure. They are the best because they have the best teachers who can convey the message in the best possible way. Right? Now, before I spend more time here, let's move on to the next one. What do you think is the next important thing? I already heard somebody mention about something.
Presentation?
The whole thing is a presentation, actually. I would not term that as a topic. What are you saying? Right? Very essential. you need to know that everybody judges you on the basis of your grammar. I do, trust me. If I meet someone who says, I did not went there yesterday, stay away from me. I've already judged you. A lot of times people, you know, judge you on the basis of the grammar, the grammatical mistakes that you make, right? So, are we really looking for something like this? No, I'm not talking about the one that you see on your left. Definitely not. What I mean by good grammar is basic, understandable, plain grammar which has a certain level of attractiveness to it, right? Poetry, for example. Excellent example of this. Probably William Shakespeare's poetry might be a bit complicated for most of you, but trust me, the way that he has, you know, strung the beads of words and figures of speech, amazing, right? So, I hope nobody is doing this. This is extremely good grammar, which nobody understands. This is extremely bad grammar, which kind of...
I understand.
Good for you, my boy. Right? So, language is a very important aspect. Now, let's move on before time makes fools of ourselves. What do you think is the next most important thing? It's kind of related to what she said, so I'll not spend time here as well. Your body language. Before, okay, so scientific fact. Please feel free to Google it and correct me if I'm wrong. You are judged when you meet a new person on the first 8 seconds of your meeting. First 8 seconds. That's human instinct. It has come down from when we were hunters. First 8 seconds, remember that. And, and that span is shrinking now. Now, how are you in, let's say, a meeting, right? You're sitting, leaned back, probably one leg over the other. Shows disinterest, shows that you're getting bored. When somebody's talking to you, let's say a manager is telling you about, you know, certain fallacies that you've done in your work. You're standing like this, shows that you're not open. When you're giving a speech, for example, if you're like this, shows you're nervous. Make sure your body is always open to everyone so that you don't give the wrong impressions to anybody. Right? So these are some examples that I found out about body language. And body language is the thing that is perceived by not your conscious mind, but by your subconscious mind, which is even worse. Because you can change somebody's opinion about yourself, but if it's stored in their conscious mind. But if it's in their unconscious mind, bye-bye. Better not meet that person again. Now I see the timer is already reshuffling the cards, so I'll not spend too much time here as well, because we all know how body language can be a very dangerous tool, or sometimes a very effective tool of communication. At the end of the day, it is the way that you speak is what makes most amount of difference. Why is Amitabh Bachchan's voice better? He's known as the voice of the nation today, right? So again, two extreme examples, but we need to be careful to be somewhere in the middle. We don't want to be someone who is never heard. The voice that is never heard never helps anyone. And we also don't want to be the guy who is constantly nagging, you know, I want to do this, I want to do that, in a voice that is... I struggle with this a lot. At my workplace, when I'm in a meeting, I have those big Jabra, you know, noise cancellation headphones. And when I get excited, my voice tends to go up. And the people around me are like, hey, I'm like, okay, sorry, sorry, sorry. So I struggle with this, but it's practice that makes man perfect. Or a woman, in this case. So you need to practice to control your emotions, to control your voice, to control your volume, to control your pitch, to control your pace. If you don't do that, then all the content in the world is getting ignored. Right? So, last and my favorite one. It is what you know makes you who you are. Right? I've had a lot of discussions with people on a very... And I wouldn't say intellectual, but on a certain standard of thinking. And there are other people around us who are like, okay, that's me. Because all they see is the first problem. You can't debate with people like those. So don't be this guy. because this guy is extremely dangerous. If you choose to remain ignorant, well, you might be blissful, but in real life, you're getting nowhere. Always be up to date with the current affairs. Always read books. Always talk to people. Always know what their thoughts are. Because only if you know what, you know, people think, or you know what the actual thing is, only will then will you succeed. Let's say, for example, when you're talking to Bill, right? So, not knowing where what IoT is in the first place is not going to gain you points, but knowing what IoT is in SAP and what their strategy might look like, what the standings are right now, that's going to gain you points in his book, right? So, can we take a quick recap? I have very less time. First one.
Ice cream.
Second one.
Structure.
Third.
Point.
What's
the point?
Fourth.
Language.
Fifth.
Body language.
Sixth.
Voice.
Seventh.
Knowledge.
Eighth.
Grammar.
If you do not have the confidence to stand in front of a person and convey your thoughts to them, you, ladies and gentlemen, my dear friends, are going to get nowhere. With this, I end my talk, and I will see you if you have any doubts after the break. Thank you so much.